Okay, we will discuss how to characterize triangulability and then diagonalizability today. Okay. Okay, in particular we have the following. T is a linear operator on a finite dimensional vector space V. Let me say I have lambda 1, lambda 2, etc., lambda k. Be the distinct eigenvalues. Of T, then T is triangulable if and only if the minimal polynomial M of T can be written as a product of linear factors T minus lambda 1 to the R1, T minus lambda 2 to the R2, etc., T minus lambda k to the Rk. Okay, one part is easy. See, this is an if and only if statement, necessary and sufficient. If T is triangulable, then the minimal polynomial has this representation. If the minimal polynomial has this representation, then T is triangulable. That is the second part. If T is triangulable, then the minimal polynomial has this representation is easy. So let us look at that quickly. By definition, T is triangulable if there is a basis B of V such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is an upper triangular matrix. So I am doing the first part. There exists, I am doing the first part. That is, if T is triangulable, I want to show that the minimal polynomial has this form. Okay, there exists a basis of V such that the matrix of T relative to this basis is of this form: a11, a21, a31, etc., an1, 0, a22, a32, etc., an2, 0, 0, etc. All these entries are 0, the last one is ann. Upper triangular matrix. The matrix of T relative to B is an upper triangular matrix. This is the, these are the entries along the principal diagonal. Below this entry, below this principal diagonal, all entries are 0. That is an upper triangular matrix. So if T is triangulable, then T, the matrix of T relative to B is of this form. We need to show that the minimal polynomial of T is this, but that is straightforward because it is an upper triangular matrix, the eigenvalues are precisely the diagonal elements. Okay. And so the characteristic polynomial of this matrix will be lambda T minus A11 into T minus A22, etc., T minus ANN, it is of this form. Some of these diagonal entries could repeat. So the minimal polynomial, this is the expression I gave for the characteristic polynomial. The minimal polynomial must divide the characteristic polynomial, and it also has the same roots as the characteristic polynomial. So the minimal polynomial is of this form. Okay. So write this quickly. Then P of T is T minus A11, T minus A22, etc., T minus ANN. And so MT has a required form. There is nothing in this part. Okay, so first part is easy. Second part will make use of the previous result. The previous lemma states that if the minimal polynomial factors in this manner, then and if W is an invariant proper invariant subspace, then there exists an x such that x does not belong to W, but T minus lambda j x belongs to W. Okay, we will use that lemma repeatedly. So for the converse, conversely, suppose that the minimal polynomial has that required form. I'll start with W naught as the subspace. The subspace consisting of just singleton 0. This is an invariant subspace for any operator. Okay. So I'll use the previous lemma. The minimal polynomial has this form. I'll use the previous lemma for this subspace. There exists, I'll call it I'll start with W1. There exists X1 which does not belong to W, which means X1 is not 0. There exists X1 which does not belong to W, but T minus such that T minus lambda j I of X1 that belongs to W1 by the previous lemma. You must verify that the conditions of the previous lemma are satisfied. The conditions of the previous lemma are M can be written as a product of linear factors, W must be an invariant subspace, proper invariant subspace, the case here, and then this happens for any operator T. Is that okay? X1 does not belong to W1. Okay, such that T minus lambda j, where lambda j is some eigenvalue, that is also important. Lambda j is some eigenvalue, that is why I have written like this. Lambda j represents one of these, I am just emphasizing. Lambda j is some eigenvalue, just to emphasize. What I do next is take the subspace spanned by X1. This is not 0, so I will go to the next step, that is span of X1. This is an eigenvector. X1 is an eigenvector. W1 is singleton 0, so X1 is an eigenvector. So W2 is an invariant subspace. T of W2 is contained in W2. W2 is an invariant subspace. I apply the previous lemma to the subspace W2 to get X2 which does not belong to W2. Now X2 does not belong to W2. What is the conclusion? If it is not in W2, then it is not a multiple of X1. So X1 and X2 are linearly independent. X1, X2 linearly independent. That is what it means. W2 is multiple of X1. If X2 is not in W2, then X1, X2 are linearly independent. Then with this I get such that T minus let us say some lambda I identity X2, this belongs to W2. Again lambda I is some eigenvalue. But I need to interpret this now. I need to interpret this so that I can proceed by induction. What is the meaning of T minus lambda I of X2 being in W2? This means that Tx2 is some lambda I X2 plus this belongs to W2, W2 is span of X1. So let us say some alpha 11 X1. I will rewrite this as alpha 11 X1 plus some lambda I times X2. That is my Tx2. Do you agree? T minus lambda X2 belongs to W2, W2 is span X1, so it is some multiple of X1. Tx2 minus lambda x2 is that alpha 11 x1. So I get this. I have just rewritten it like this because remember you should always remember what we are trying to prove. We want to construct a basis B such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is upper triangular. Given the minimal polynomials of this form, we want to show that T is triangulable. Okay. Can you see the first steps of how to construct that basis? I have X1 here, X1, X2 here. This is going to be our basis. I want to write down the matrix of T relative to this basis. So what is the first column? Let us preempt. What is the first column of the matrix of T relative to this basis supposed to have been constructed? That is X1, X2, etc., Xn is what I am going to construct. That is my basis. What is Tx1? In terms of x1, x2, etc., xn. first step. Tx1 equals lambda j x1. There are no other terms. So the first column, first entry is lambda j, all other entries are 0. I want to look at Tx2. Tx2 I have already written. Tx2 I have already written. I want to write Tx2 in terms of x1, x2, etc., xn, but I see that it is a linear combination of only x1 and x2. Coefficient of x1 alpha 11. Coefficient of x2 is some number, it is an eigenvalue, but does not matter. The second column is first non-zero entry, second non-zero entry, all other entries 0. That is how I get the upper triangular matrix. Okay, so these are the first steps of constructing that basis. So this is my Tx2. I proceed by induction to get the following. Wn minus 1 for me, I am assuming that the dimension of the space V is n. I have written now. The sum r1 plus r2 etc. rk, I am sorry, not for the minimal polynomial, the dimension of the space is assumed to be n always. I look at Wn minus 1. Wn minus 1 by definition is span of the first n minus 1 vectors. I have constructed x1, x2 etc. xn minus 1. Having constructed x1 etc. xn minus 1, I will construct xn, last step. There is one less, right? So, okay. For W1 singleton 0, W2 is this, which means I must go to Wn. I go to Wn and then construct Xn plus 1. Okay. Wn is it okay? Right. W2 is span of x1, that is invariant under T. W3 will be span of x1, x2, is that invariant under T? For x1 there is no problem, for x2 what happens? Just now I have written down the expression for Tx2. Tx2 is a linear combination of x1 and x2, so I go back. So W2, sorry, W3 is invariant under T, do you agree? So I proceed by induction. Is that clear? See, after this step I construct W3, right? That is span of x1, x2. Is this invariant under T? It is enough. It is invariant. Is it invariant under T? So I look at the action of T on each of the vectors. Tx1, no problem. It is just, it is an eigenvalue. Lambda j is an eigenvalue. X1 is an eigenvector. X2 is not an eigenvector. Let us remember that. X2 is not an eigenvector. Okay. X2, if X2 were an eigenvector, this term would not be there. X2 is not an eigenvector. In fact, this is called a generalized eigenvector. Okay. X2 is not an eigenvector, but it is independent with X1, and X2 has the property that Tx2 has this representation. Okay. So what? If you look at Tx1, of course, it is a multiple of X1. If you look at Tx2, it is a linear combination of X1 and X2, which means T of W3 is contained in W3. T of W3 is contained, see every step you need to verify that the subspace you have got is invariant under T. T of W3 is invariant under, W3 is invariant under T. Proceed by induction, this can be shown to be invariant under T. Now I can apply the previous lemma. For one last time, there exists Xn which does not belong to this subspace Wn, but which has a property that T minus, I will call it lambda s I Xn, this belongs to Wn. Again expand as before, that is Txn equals lambda s Xn plus some vector in the subspace, I will call it U, U belongs to Wn. Now U is in Wn, Wn is spanned by these are linearly independent by induction. So Wn has this as a basis in fact. So this is a linear combination of this. Let me write that as alpha n1 x1 plus alpha n2 x2 etc. alpha n minus 1, I am sorry, alpha n n minus 1. There are n minus 1 vectors here. Alpha n n minus 1 xn minus 1 Now I'll write this term lambda as xn as a last term, because I want to write down the last column of the matrix of T relative to this basis. This is a basis. Which is a basis? X1, X2, etc. Xn is a basis. Why is that a basis, by the way? First few steps we have seen. X1, X2, etc. Xn. But why are they independent? Because none is a linear combination of the. A set of vectors is linearly dependent if and only if at least one of them is a linear combination of the preceding vectors. Now that does not happen at all. So these are independent. Okay. So don't think this result we proved long ago is useless. It comes here. Okay. Finally, what have we done? We have written Txn as a linear combination of x1, etc., xn, which means the last column of T relative to this basis B. So I will now write down B as x1, x2, etc., xn constructed in this manner. Then it is clear that the matrix of T relative to this basis is a diagonal upper triangular form. I can actually write down, right? The first entry is that the first entry is at lambda j, all the other entries are 0. For the second column, alpha 1 1 lambda I, all other entries are 0, etc. These entries will be non-zero. The last entry here is lambda s. So it's an upper triangular matrix. So is the proof clear now? So if the minimal polynomial factors into linear factors, then the matrix, then the operator is diagonalizable, rather triangulable. Is it clear? Let's do a problem. Let's look at an example of an operator which is not diagonalizable but which is triangulable. By the way, there is a corollary to this result which I stated even in the last lecture, which is that if you know that all the eigenvalues of an operator lie in the underlying field that you started with, then it is triangulable. In particular, if the underlying field is an algebraically closed field, then any operator T is triangulable. What is an algebraically closed field? A field is said to be algebraically closed if the irreducible polynomials are linear polynomials. If the only irreducible polynomials of the field are linear polynomials, R is not algebraically closed. The polynomial T square plus 1 is irreducible, it is not linear. C is algebraically closed, for example. Okay. So over an algebraically closed field, any operator is triangulable. Okay. So rotation operator in some sense is irredeemable because the eigenvalues are complex numbers. But let's look at the second example. This the operator T on R3, whose matrix with respect to the standard basis given here is not diagonalizable. That operator is not diagonalizable. The characteristic polynomial of this matrix is T minus 1 into T minus 2 the whole square. This is not diagonalizable. What I know is that if x1 is, okay, let me put it the other way around. I'll start with x1. What I know is that if x1 is 1 1 2, then this is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue 2. This is the only independent eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue 2, because the rank of A minus lambda 2i is 2, and so the null space has dimension 1. That is the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue 2. So this is the only eigenvector, non-zero eigenvector for lambda 2 equals 2, independent eigenvector. For lambda equals lambda 1 equals 1, so I am one short for the eigenvalue 2. Let me also write down x3 as I'll construct x2 using the procedure that we described just now. X3, I will write this as the eigenvector corresponding to eigenvalue 1. I know there is only one independent vector. If I remember right, it is 102. This is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. I want to show that this is triangulable. This is not diagonalizable, but I want to show this is triangulable, okay. So I must get a basis. I must get one independent vector. I know that this independent vector cannot be an eigenvector. X1, X3 are independent. Obviously, they correspond to eigenvectors which are distinct, even by inspection. One is not a multiple of the other. These are independent. For a basis, I want one more independent vector, okay. Now, this vector I know cannot be an eigenvector because eigenvectors have been exhausted. It has to be a generalized eigenvector constructed like the previous procedure. So let us do that. There are several ways of doing it. I will do one, I will apply one method. What I will do is to look at the span of x3. I am sorry, I want to look at x1. I want to look at x1. X3 will not work. You please experiment. Span of x1 corresponding to 2, I will take w to be this. By the previous, by the way, this is an eigenvalue, so this w is invariant under t. X1 is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue. So this is, this subspace invariant under t. So by the previous lemma, by the way, the minimal polynomial factors as a product of linear factors. Okay, I can apply the lemma. There exists x3 which does not belong to w, but t minus lambda I x3 belongs to w for some eigenvalue lambda. I want x2, yes, I want to determine x2 such that x2 does not belong to w. So x2 and x1 are linearly independent, but t minus lambda I x2 belongs to w. For some eigenvalue lambda, you will see that it will correspond to the eigenvalue 2, but this is not an eigenvector. Let us remember that again. So t minus lambda, so t x2 equals lambda x2. I want to actually solve this, right? I want to find x2. So let me write like, I want to solve for x2. So I will look at t minus lambda I x2. It belongs to w, w span x1. I will take x1 itself, 1, 1, 2. Again experiment, this lambda cannot be 1, it will have to be 2. I will not answer why. I am doing for a, okay. So I am looking at a minus lambda I, lambda equals 2. So I delete 2, 1, 1 minus 1, 2, 0 minus 1. 2, 2 minus 2, x2 is what, I am sorry, x1 is what I am looking at, 1, 1, 2. This is the same as this, right, multiple, so I can delete this and what follows is that, okay, I can right away solve this. I have these equations. For the moment, I will call this x, okay. So my objective is to solve for x from this equation. To solve for x from this equation, the solution I will call it x2. That's one, right. So, okay, two equations, three unknowns, I need to fix one, I will take x3. X3 equal to 0 will work because this is invertible. So x3 equal to 0. X1 plus X2 equals 1, 2X1 equals 1, X1 is 1 by 2, X2 is 1 by 2. Can you check if this is correct, the computations here, 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2, that is 1, and this X3 is 0, okay. This last row is the same as the first row multiplied by 2, so this is one solution. But I need to be careful to see that this is independent of the other one. Are they independent? You are going to tell me this. Can someone make a quick calculation of the determinant and tell me that this is independent? Are they independent? Yes? You are sure? Okay. Have you verified? You need to verify that this 3/3 determinant is not 0. Okay, let's assume the computations are correct. Then what is a matrix of T relative to this basis? That is, I know that A is similar to an upper triangular matrix. In terms of matrices, that's what it means. A is similar to an upper triangular matrix. That is triangulability. P inverse AP equal to C, where C is an upper triangular matrix. What are the entries? X1 is an eigenvalue, eigenvector, so that is 2. These entries are 0. X2 corresponds to a generalized eigenvector, so that will go with what are the entries here? Tx2 equals x1 plus lambda 0 0 0 1. Okay, please check this. How did I get the first column? First column corresponds to, see, this is the order in which I write x1, x2, x3. For the x1 corresponds to eigenvalue 2, x2 is a generalized eigenvector for the eigenvalue 2, x3 is corresponds to the eigenvalue 1. So Tx3 is 1 times x3, that is this. Tx1 is 2 times x1, that is this. I need to only verify Tx2, but Tx2, x2 is a solution of this system. So Tx2 is x1 plus 2 times x2, x1 plus 2 times x2. This is the upper triangular form which is similar to the matrix A. What is P? Just pad up those eigenvectors. This is P. This P is invertible because it consists of x1, x2, x3 which form a basis for R3. So this P is invertible, okay. So this is an example. We know that diagonalizability does not work for this example, but since we know that the eigenvalues, all the eigenvalues lie in the underlying field, we know that this can be triangulated. We have done that. We have triangulated this matrix. Is that clear? Okay. Then finally, diagonalizability. Characterization of diagonalizability. Okay, that's an important result. Let's prove that result. Do you have any questions before I proceed to the next important theorem? Okay, I want to characterize diagonalizability. T is a linear operator on a finite dimensional vector space. This is diagonalizable if and only if the minimal polynomial of the operator T is a product of distinct linear factors. is diagonalizable if and only if T is a product of, if and only if the minimal polynomial is a product of distinct linear factors, of which one part we have seen earlier. If T is diagonalizable, then the minimal polynomial is a product of distinct linear factors. We have seen that. First part was proved earlier. If you don't remember it, we can recall it quickly. If T is diagonalizable, then M is the minimal polynomial is a product of distinct linear factors, comes because, for one thing, the minimal polynomial cannot be of a degree less than this polynomial, because the minimal polynomial has to have each eigenvalue as a 0. You can't go less than this. Now, is this an annihilating polynomial? If you show that this is an annihilating polynomial, you are through, because the coefficient of t to the k is 1. So, it is a monic, least degree, just show it is an annihilating polynomial. To show that it is an annihilating polynomial, you show that m of capital T is 0. M of capital T, let us call it S. You want to show S is a 0 operator. You show that T is diagonalizable, so there is a basis for the vector space V, each of whose vector is an eigenvector for T. You want to show S is 0, show that S of x equal to 0 for all eigenvectors x, okay. But S of x, you know that the products can be rewritten. T minus lambda 1 into T minus lambda 2 is T minus lambda 2 into T minus lambda 1. This is what we use to show that since this x is an eigenvector, you have to go to that place where the eigenvalue figures and then push it to the right corner, you will get m of t to be 0. That is the proof for the first part. If t is diagonalizable, then this is a minimal polynomial, has been proved earlier. It is a converse part that is important. So, suppose m has this form, we will prove that t is diagonalizable, okay. Suppose that M is a product, M is the product of distinct linear polynomials. We want to show that T is diagonalizable. I want to show that T is diagonalizable, okay. What I do is, I will set W to be the space generated by all the eigenvectors. Suppose W is a subspace generated by all the eigenvectors of T. If W equals V, then I am through. If W equals V, then I can extract a basis for this space. This basis is a subset of W, so each vector is an eigenvector, that is the definition of diagonalizability. So, if W is equal to V, there is nothing to prove. If W is not equal to V, we will arrive at a contradiction. Okay. W is the space generated by all the eigenvectors, so it is invariant under T. W is invariant under T, okay. I will appeal to that lemma. See how that lemma is so crucial. The lemma can be applied because the minimal polynomial is a product of linear factors. There exists x which does not belong to W, but T minus lambda x belongs to W. For some eigenvalue lambda. let me call this as y. And this y belongs to W. Now y is in W. W is a subspace generated by all the eigenvectors. Let us say x1, x2, etc. Okay. For for lambda 1, there are several eigenvectors. Those eigenvectors span the eigenspace corresponding to lambda 1. For lambda 2, there are several eigenvectors. Those independent eigenvectors span the eigenspace for lambda 2, etc. In any case, I can look at any vector in W, I can look at it as y1 plus y2, etc. plus yk, where y1 is the linear combination, y1 belongs to eigenspace corresponding to lambda 1, y2 belongs to eigenspace corresponding to lambda 2, etc. So, I am really writing y as y1 plus y2 etc. plus yk, where remember w, see y belongs to w, w is the eigenspace corresponding to all the eigenvectors. So, it can be partitioned as y1 plus y2 etc., w1 plus w2 etc., wk. So, this y1 comes from w1, y2 comes from w2 etc., yk comes from wk, w1, w2, w3 etc., wk are the eigenspaces. So, I can say this much, where y1 is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda 1. So, I have t y1 equals lambda 1 y1 etc., t yk equals lambda k yk. I will write Tyi equals lambda I Yi for all I. Is it clear? W corresponds to the subspace generated by all the eigenvectors. So, I can do this. Tyi equals lambda I Yi. Now, what is for any polynomial? Okay, you tell me if this statement is correct. We have seen this before. We have seen this before, so let us recall the following. Suppose Tx equals lambda x, then Gtx is G lambda x. I want to make use of this. If x is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda, then for any polynomial G, I have this. For any polynomial h of t, I have h of t y equals h of t y1 plus h of t y2 plus h of t y k. Take any polynomial h and then look at h of capital T, that is a linear operator, apply that to this equation. Now, I will appeal to the previous one. For t, y1 is an eigenvector. So, that corresponds to the eigenvalue lambda 1. I have these equations here. So, this can be written as h of lambda 1 y1 plus h at lambda 2 y2 etc. h at lambda k yk. For any polynomial h, I have this. Now, I look at the minimal polynomial. I started with that x, right? So, I have the following. M of t, m is a minimal polynomial, so it is a 0 operator. So, mtx is 0 for the x that we started with. Let us not lose track of this x. X is the one which has this property. It does not belong to W, but T minus lambda x belongs to W. So, 0 equal to mtx. I want to look at the polynomial MT. What I know is that M of lambda, I should give this some name now. Okay. See, this is for some eigenvalue lambda, I will call this lambda j. Okay. I have y equals t minus lambda j I of x. I am calling lambda by lambda j. That is one of the eigenvalues. Lambda is one of the eigenvalues. In particular, I am using this for that. For lambda, I am using lambda j. Okay. Now, I can write MT as t minus lambda j into q of t. M of lambda j is 0. And I have removed one factor, t minus lambda j into q of t. Degree of q of t is less than degree of m of t. So, q of capital T cannot be 0. In particular, q of lambda j is not 0. Do you agree that q of lambda j cannot be 0? Because if q of lambda j is 0, it means m has lambda j appearing twice as a root. But m is a product of distinct linear factors. If q of lambda j is 0, this will have t minus lambda j as one factor. So, m will have t minus lambda j power 2, which is not the case. So, q of lambda j is not 0. I wanted to consider this polynomial. Consider h of t, okay, as q of t minus q of lambda j. Consider this polynomial h of t q t minus q lambda j, then h of lambda j is 0, q lambda j minus q lambda j. H lambda j is 0, lambda j is a 0 of h, so t minus lambda j is a factor of h. So, h of t can be written as t minus lambda j into some polynomial. I will use f of t. I will go back to this equation and write q of t minus q of lambda j. This is equal to h of t has been written in this manner. So, that is t minus lambda j into f of t. F is some polynomial. Now, look at q of capital T x minus q lambda j x, q of capital T x minus q lambda j x. That is, I am now applying the operator T. Instead of little t, I take the operator T. So, on the left, the operator q of T minus q lambda j is a number. Operator q of T minus q j equals operator t minus lambda j into the operator f of capital T. Two operators are equal, then their actions on each vector must be equal. So, q t x minus q lambda j x equals, I will write this as f of capital T, t minus lambda j I x, okay. T minus lambda j I x, I am calling that as y. So, this is f of t y. The vector y comes from w. So, f t y must belong to w. So, this is in w. Do you agree? Look at the definition of y. Y is t minus lambda I x belongs to w. So, since w is an invariant subspace under t, f t y must belong to w. So, the right hand side vector belongs to w. This belongs to w. So, this difference belongs to w. This difference belongs to w. Can q t x belong to w? From this, what is the answer? Okay, this is what I have. Q capital T x minus Q lambda j x, this belongs to W. Finally, after all the struggle, can Q T x belong to W? If Q T x belongs to W, it means I can cancel Q T x. It will mean Q lambda j x belongs to W, but x does not belong to W. A constant times x belongs to W means that constant has to be 0. The constant is not 0. Q lambda j is not 0. Do you agree with this? If Q T x is 0, this means this vector must be, this is a multiple of x that belongs to W, but x does not belong to W. So this has to be 0, but Q lambda j is not 0. So z is not 0. The vector z equals Q T x is not 0, okay. But what is it that this QT satisfies? Okay, so I go back to MTX. This is T minus lambda ji QT of x. See, I am going back to the equation using m of t is, m is an annihilating polynomial, okay. 0 equals mtx, mt has this representation, mt has this representation, t minus lambda j qt, so t minus lambda j I q capital Tx, this is t minus lambda j I of z, I am calling qtx as z. What have we proved? That is tz equals lambda jz with z not equal to 0. We have proved that tz equals lambda z, lambda jz with z not equal to 0, that is z is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda j. That means z belongs to W. If z belongs to W, Q lambda j is 0, contradiction. Is it clear? That is z belongs to W. Why? Because since z is an eigenvector, see, this is as I told, this is a cornerstone and the proof is slightly involved, but see the beauty of the proof. Z is an eigenvector, so z must belong to W, but z is precisely qtx. Qtx belongs to W, again the same story. If qtx belongs to W, then q lambda jx must belong to W, but if that happens, then q lambda j is 0 again. But this is a contradiction. This is a contradiction to what? This is a you will see that each of these steps is consistent with the previous step. Each of these steps is consistent with the previous step. So the problem is in the beginning. I have removed it. W not equal to V. W not equal to V is not consistent with the hypothesis of the theorem. If W is the subspace generated by all the eigenvectors of T, and if W is not equal to V, then I have a contradiction, and so W must be equal to V. This is what we wanted to prove. The space V is generated by all the eigenvectors of T, that is, there is a basis B for V such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is diagonal, okay. Let me stop here.